First of all, big thanks to the organizers of this conference and everyone who came, and to you, esteemed colleagues. Now, so that we do not lose time, I will just start. So my name again is Idan. I am an Israeli anthropologist and photographer. In my work, I explore the history of anthropology, travels, and the passage of ideas of ancient cultures. In my work, I seek to emphasize the relationships between indigenous cultures and contemporary culture. My master thesis, as you said, dealt with Indianism in Israel and the way in which Native Americanism is located in the field of Israeli identity. My doctoral thesis, dissertation, will deal with the same areas of research and most likely the countries of the southern corner of the American continent. Within this conference, which deals with interactions between religious and political in the United States, we will talk today about one of the unexpected expressions that these interactions have, the shaping of Native Americanism in the identity outside of the United States. We will do this through the case of the Israeli Indians that I will introduce to you in a moment. But just before I start, I will just ask that I saw it happening as well, but if you have any questions, please keep them to the end. I hope I'll be able to answer everything along the way. And I will also say and apologize in advance that I will not be able to be connected to the chat and also talk at the same time. So it is better that if you have something to say or something to add, please add it in the end. Okay. So I'll start with the some important introductions. If we're already talking about politics, first, the use of the term Indian for those who are native to American continent. Secondly, what I based my research on and how this topic relates to this conference that we all came together for. I will briefly mention the literature which discusses this subject and say a few words about the historical background of research in this field. I will then proceed with a brief description of the Israeli Indian village and the combination its members mix between Native American culture and Judaism, and how it enables them to avoid geographical and historical limitation in shaping their identities. Okay, so let's start with the most politically correct question I hear when I talk about this subject. Why and how do I use the term Indians, this general term that originated by mistake? So the use I will make of this term, Indians, to describe people who lived in America before the arrival of the white man, is certainly complex and full of difficulties. It is an inclusive term and, of course, an expression of racism. Indeed, to call a cultural complex of the American continent by one comprehensive name, it is very problematic. For this reason, you probably know many scholars are careful to use the term Native Americans, certainly preferred in the discourse of identities. Despite this, and despite the understanding of the difficulty involved, I will use here the old and bad nickname Indians. But why? First, the use of the term Native American in the study of the culture that does not exist in the Americas is problematic, both as to the clear geographical limitation and because of the negative connection of the term native. Although it is used in popular discourse today in a positive way, the term native still connects to a Eurocentric colonial heritage and the accompanying meaning of less developed, the opposite of the positive value I attach to the nation in question. Second, and this is the main reason for my use in the term Indian, is that in all the meetings I have held and all the places I have visited, the participants have routinely and without any hesitation used the term Indian in reference to themselves and Native American cultures. In Israel, the term Indian has no socio-political significance at all. In an attempt to look for a less ideologically charged concept to describe non-Western knowledge, anthropologists have used terms such as local, ecological, environmental, or popular. Similarly, the term traditional is also under scrutiny because it implies the mention of freezing in time and a lack of internal variability. Politically, the term local is admittedly less charged than the term native, as it lacks the meaning of the cultural stagnation, but on the other hand, is rather vague. Another problem, the concept of local, is that it is impossible to distinguish between reference to the culture and reference to the geographical location. So in this lecture, the term local could not have been used as a substitute for the term native, for the simple reason that the knowledge I'm referring to is not entirely a local product. The word native has additional weight in Israel context, since even if there is a debate about the question of the characterization of Zionism as a colonial settlement movement, it will not be ignored that the term native is associated in Israel with the Palestinian people. Although in our conversation, I will not address the colonial Israeli-Palestinian issue, but I am aware of the lively debate that is taking place on the issue and being in the background of this conversation. To sum up this point, words that signify identity are always politically charged, certainly reference the minority groups that have been victims of European colonialism. Paradoxically, new concepts that replace old concepts as part of the struggle to recognize historical injustice often fall into the trap of identity politics. As I have demonstrated on the term native and Indian, therefore in our discussion below, I will use the term Indian because, as I mentioned, this is the term used by the people I met in the field. It is worth noting that their use of the term sometimes stems from a romantic longing for a primal and pure lifestyle, sometimes from a commercial interest, and sometimes it is done with utter casualness. And yet, wherever I can use other terms that are not politically charged, I will do so. So let's begin. So my field work was conducted between 2018 and 2019 through participatory observation, in-depth conversations, and open interviews at three major research sites in Israel: a tourist attraction that uses the Native American theme, a center for Native American medicine, and the village of Tierra, a fictitious name, of course, for the Jewish Indian tribe. During the research period, I researched a number of Native American hotspots in Israel: markets, festivals, businesses, institutions, workshops, tribal kindergartens, Indian hospitality villages, Indian ceremonial sites, and other places like this. My visits to those places and my participation in the activities that take place in them opened a window for me to Indianism as it takes shape in Israel's space and within the context of New Age movement in Israel. However, most of my research was done within the framework of the Jewish Indian tribe of the village of Tierra. There I was able to get to know closely the practices, customs, understandings, and people who live in Israel with the identity component they call Indian. In this talk, we will take a look at the lives of the Jewish Indian tribe, a group of Israelis in Israel who define themselves as Indians. And through their case, we will discuss the unexpected ways in which the fluidity of the interaction between politics and religion in the United States contributes to the shaping of Native Americanism identity outside of America. When we look at the history of the subject, we see that identity has always fascinated Indianity was always fascinated Western thinking and has been inspiration for countless expressions. From the beginning of European settlement in America that adopted the native way of life, to popular shows of the Wild West, to anthropological studies. As a rule, it can be said that the Native American image often plays the role of the ultimate other, an almost ideal representation of what is not Western, though reinforcing romantic ideas of the primitive, not ruined culture. These ideas were glorified as part of the processes of urbanization, industrialization, and globalization, which in turn contributed to the elimination of indigenous cultures that at the same time inspired romantics and novelists. Alongside this, global capitalism, nationalism, and social and environmental threats have led to the expansion of contemporary phenomena known as the New Age, a cultural scene that develops mainly in wealthy capitalist societies. This culture encourages spiritual development while learning and practicing ritual ideas and practices from a variety of cultures, especially from the non-Western world. Many New Age studies focus on those who draw inspiration and seek to emulate the context, practices, and identities, characteristics of Native American culture as perceived in the West. In terms of personal and collective identity in the United States in this context today, it is intertwined with the historical acts of imitation and adoption, such as Boston Tea Party and the Red Man Order. These were used by Europeans to shape their national identities and to establish the status of the continent's native as others. The historical background associated with the relationship between the American nation and the native that preceded it allows us to see how the political and religious definition helped determine the nature of American identity. Those clear definitions made it possible to answer questions such as, who is an American? Who is not? Where can you be an American and when? Who is Native American and who is an immigrant? Today, boundaries of political and religious definition in America and in the world are becoming increasingly fluid. This makes it much harder to answer questions of this kind. And more than that, it allows the individual not to be limited by them. The research discussion about Native American cultures unfold across different discourses. Barnes, for example, showed that it expanded with the crystallization of anthropology as academic discipline and was based on ethnographic descriptions invaded by professionals, clerics and scholars from the various fields of knowledge during the 19th century. And scholars such as Arnon Gottfeld have stressed that the controversial ways of gathering information have led to the development of comprehensive theories of speculative nature and often with an almost trivial historical connection. The discussion about Indians in Israel directly is almost non-existent and is associated with the discussion of Indianism in the Western culture and New Age movement and questions like ours, which are related to identity. The literature dealing with Western Indianism is usually connected with historical overview of the integration between indigenous and Western cultures. There one can find a discussion of questions about the geographical and social location of Western Indians and slightly tired debate about identity in the post-ethnic era, an identity based on the adoption of myths and rituals in a reality where ethnicity is in fact far from disappearing. The anthropological discourse of the New Age, prompted by Adam Mackiewicz, sees Indianism as postmodern world phenomena that mainly attracts members of the self-realization movement. He argues that identity as a general term that includes various elements that are mistakenly taken for granted. The academic discussion on the subject also deals with various aspects of the legacy of misrepresentation and the terminological complexity I mentioned earlier. One way or another, and in the context of our conversation today, the researchers discussing the subject point to a close connection between fluid boundaries and the adoption of identity characteristics. The central issue in our joint conversation then is that of the building of a local identity as a function of negotiations with the political and religious fringes in America, in which the integration between Israeli culture and the Native American culture is created. It is important to understand that for many Israelis today, the United States is a model for a life full of possibilities, but at the same time, a political and religious reality that is very difficult to achieve in their living environment. The New Age movement, which involves access to a global spiritual world, allows Israeli indirect access to an American life experience. Under New Age culture, Israelis can be Americans, even if they were not born or physically present in America. The price they have to pay is to be on the religious and political fringes of both societies. And in an age where identity boundaries are so blurred, it is not too heavy price to pay for certain people. My research on Native Americanism in Israel shows that New Age culture in Israel offers local versions of religion and spirituality that make it possible to deal with the challenges of marginalization through a variety of values, myths, concepts, images, and practices, the use of which provides a flexible and broad solution. I will now expand a little on the Jewish Indian tribe. I will discuss how Indianism fits into the fabric of personal and collective ethno-national identity in Israel. And I will complete and conclude by explaining how the fluidity of political and religious boundaries in Western cultures allows this Israeli to build their Native American identities. So the village of Tiera is a small village on mountainside in northern Israel. It is about 20 buildings, It is isolated from any other locality and does not appear on any of the area maps. As the time writing this article, not even in online maps. There are about 70 families living in it, and it is not divided or shaped in any way. A short bumpy dirt road leads to it from the main car road, which serves as an access road to a suburban Druze settlement nearby. A small wooden sign guides those who came to the place. The entrance gate to the village is made of metal collected in various places and bent forks attached to it. I'm not showing the picture of the gate because I don't want the real name to be known. The village main walking trail is adorned with flowers, as you can see, artifacts inspired by Native American cultures and cacti that originates in deserts in the United States and Mexico. The smell of smoke rising from the houses, manure burned in nearby landfill, and the sight of the many plants is reminiscent of the smell of isolated villages in South America. Small vegetable gardens adorn the yards of small houses. The houses, some visible from the main working path and some not, are made of wooden boards, thick sheets of industrial nylon, reusable objects and fabrics. All of these quite surprisingly make to a sense of consistency and organization. The mother house and the art house, two large communal buildings, outline the main walking path. The ceremonial area with its large bonfire pit is hidden by small orchards and short farms plot planted by locals over the years. Narrow paths shaped by the walking of local leads to the houses. The natural grove of the trees somewhat obscures the entrances to the houses, the small warehouses and the common composting services. In most seasons and most hours of the day, the visitor may encounter groups of children running around, dogs making their way here and there, and some of the locals working the land and common plots, Another significant landscape detail is the large water facility that aims to store rainwater from the main roofs. Although rusty and no longer in use as it used to be, the water facility adorned with Native American paintings is a source of pride for the locals. I didn't know that if I show you this. Yeah, this is the... Okay. The members of the tribe divide their time between what is happening in the village and what is happening outside it. Those who are mostly in the village deal most of the time with matters that take place within it and make more free use of the common spaces, the ceremonial plaza and the art house and the village land. The members of the tribe call themselves Jew Indians, Israelis, Jews, who usually came from high socioeconomic backgrounds. Their practices and adopt identities, characteristics inspired by Native American culture. The reasons for coming to the village are different, and so is the personal background that led them to Native Americanism culture in the first hand. They do not have any particular ethnic background or have prominent common character traits. Most of them, especially those from the first group of settlers in Tierra, adopted the identity characteristics of the Indians even before they began to live together. They see themselves as representing the combination of Jewish culture and the Native American cultures of America, with Native American identity merging with the Jewish and together creating something new. Sorry. A crucial part of village life in which the combination of Jewish and Native American tradition is clearly expressed are spiritual rituals, when emphasizing the liminality of this way of life. During spiritual ceremonies, the Jewish elements take on Native American meanings and vice versa. For example, the observance of Shabbat, an event that originated in Jewish tradition, designed to give festive spiritual significance to the seventh day of the week, is known in the Hebrew language as Shabbat, which according to Judaism is considered sacred. The event is celebrated through mentions of celestial events, Native American musical instruments, and delicate dose of hallucinatory drinks. It combines prayer songs for God and the Great Spirit. Another good example is the fire ceremony of Lag BaOmer, a Jewish holiday associated with the Jewish revolt against the Roman, in where to this day it is customary to light bonfires. In Tierra, it is celebrated with dances and as an opportunity to share a common vision and pay homage to the sacred fire. In the young Jewish Indian tradition, even God is a part of the Great Spirit. Those are just examples of how Native Americanism is woven into the fabric of the personal and collective ethno-national identity of the Jewish Indian tribe. The case of the Jewish Indian tribe, briefly presented here, is an example of how integration between symbols originated in different cultures are intertwined together to create a cohesive identity. Hence, it can be stated that the synthesis exemplified here allows certain Israelis to avoid geographical and historical constraints and adapt a unique larger romantic identity that is free to have an affinity for almost unlimited number of cultural references points. In other words, Israelis who see American culture as an expression of an ideal of political and religious freedom, which usually does not exist in Israel, are no longer required to explain to themselves why they chose to live in another local restrictions. Under local restrictions. Under the blurred boundaries we are discussing, cultural synthesis is made possible and has no significant political or spiritual implications. If you want, you can be American and Israeli, Indian and Jewish. To conclude, I wanted to present the case of the Jewish Indian tribe, people who make a choice to live an American identity component that is on the political and religious fringes of the local cultural ideal. And this is an example of one of the unintended consequences of blurring the boundaries between political and religious in the United States. An examination of the case of the Jewish Indian tribe shows how the inability to define the borders allows for the expanding, and in practice turning a foreign culture into an authentic local culture. The spiritual culture of the Native Americans is especially attractive to those seeking a renewed identity for themselves. It stands on the social fringe and allows for erasure of all identity definitions and the adoption of new ones. Through processes of imitation and adoption, Israelis, like many other people in the world, allow themselves to shed the local politics and religious constraints that have limited them in the past. That's it. Thank you.